Look at that. Okay. Well, it is 3:30. It is the appointed hour for our technical session on re-envisioning the next generation of university-led nuclear innovation. So we're going to keep it going here on Einstein's birthday and we're going to go deep on some pretty technical topics with these folks here this afternoon. When I came to the NRC in 2020, I had kind of three key focus areas. Accident-tolerant fuel, advanced reactors, and academic programs. And this is my third RIC, and I think now with this one, I have covered all three of those topics, and I'm happy to say that this is the one on academic programs, and I'm absolutely thrilled to be here this afternoon to help facilitate the discussion among the participants. I'm gonna make some opening remarks, then we're gonna have presentations. We'll have some questions after each presentation, and we've got time at the end. We'll have additional questions for the entire panel. So I am very excited about this session in particular because it highlights the bright ideas and research that's being done now that will shape the work we'll be doing in 5 years. I fully support the ongoing engagement with and encouragement of students to consider pursuing careers in public service or academic research, but public service. And during my tenure as commissioner and chair, I've had the opportunity, I've been able to visit a number of test and research reactors. In fact, earlier just this month, I was at Kansas State to visit their little Trigga Mark II reactor that they're getting a tremendous amount of use of. And that's really one of the things for me is to be able to go to colleges and universities and see facilities large and small, and not just reactors, but the additional other research capabilities and the things that are being accomplished is just amazing. In my tenure, I've also been able to visit MIT and Georgia Tech, Michigan, which doesn't have a reactor at all, I would add, as well as the University of Puerto Rico at Mayagüez. And although, while not at the NRC, I was mentioning to our friends here from College Park, I've actually been to see the reactor down there as well. We've recently completed the third year of this program in our Office of Research. The research grants are highly competitive. We're excited at the overwhelming response we're getting to the research funding announcements. We've reviewed over 320 highly competitive proposals for fiscal years 2021 and 22. And awarded 46 grants. So you can see that's a pretty low selection rate on the amount of interest that we're getting. Our annual notice of funding opportunity will be issued soon, and we encourage institutions to submit projects that provide a variety of direct and indirect near and longer term benefits. And new this year, we will be considering non-technical research with an emphasis on environmental justice under this announcement. For example, work to promote dialogue that helps foster the development of innovative community ideas, incorporates principles of equity and environmental justice into community engagement strategies. We also wanted to improve our participation with minority-serving academic institutions. So to encourage greater participation, the funding notice for research projects will encourage institutions to include partnerships with minority-serving institutions. Separate from the university-led grant program, we also have reinstated the minority-serving institution grant program. These grants complement our research portfolio in areas that we're working on here at the NRC. An added benefit to these grants is that they directly engage students, university faculty, and nuclear-related programs in work of relevance to the agency and thus develop the next generation of engineers. Before we meet our panelists, I have a few housekeeping notes to share. I'd like to remind everyone to please silence your devices. For the Q&A session, your questions will be submitted through the electronic means, scan the QR code. And for those of you in the room here, again, the QR code, you'll need to log into the platform each day. For those joining virtually, once you're logged on to the virtual conference platform and joined the session, there is a tab there apparently online for your electronic Q&A. Questions from both the online participants and those using the QR code will be added to the same queue, so everybody is on a level playing field, and we'll get through as many questions as we can. So now, I'd like to introduce our speakers for this afternoon's panel. Dr. Jessica Rojas is an associate professor in the Mechanical and Nuclear Engineering Department at Virginia Commonwealth University. Dr. Henry Spitz is a professor of nuclear and radiological engineering at the University of Cincinnati College of Engineering and Applied Science. And with him is Jimmy Stringer, a PhD candidate also at the University of Cincinnati. Our third presenter is Dr. Michelle Shelby Bensey, who is an assistant professor in the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering at the University of Maryland. Dr. Bensey is joined by Joy Shen, a PhD candidate also at the University of Maryland. We'll hear from Dr. Jessica Rojas from Virginia Commonwealth University first. A little bit more about Dr. Rojas. She holds a BS in engineering physics and a master's in materials engineering and processes from the National University of Columbia, and a master's and PhD in nuclear engineering from Missouri University of Science and Technology, a university, I might add, well represented here at the NRC. Dr. Rojas's primary research interests include nuclear materials, radiation-assisted chemistry, and radiation processing. She has been actively working in accident-tolerant fuel cladding materials, investigating their physical and chemical properties. Dr. Rojas's lab also focuses on radiation synthesis of nanomaterials. Try saying that 10 times fast. Modification of nanomaterials properties through irradiation, and development of multifunctional nanomaterials as radioisotope carriers. She is an active member of the Minerals, Metals, and Materials Society and the American Nuclear Society. She has been chair and vice chair of the Virginia section of the ANS, and she is currently serving on the ANS Board of Directors. The topic of her presentation today will be advanced characterization of ATF cladding for understanding their degradation under short-time temperature excursions and implications in dry storage. I'll now turn it over to Dr. Jessica Rojas.
Okay, so first of all, I would like to thank the NRC for having me here today to talk about the progress that we have done in our research project funded by this NRC program. So before I get started, which is I always like to have this at the beginning, just to acknowledge the team members. We have a multidisciplinary group in our department, Mechanical and Nuclear Engineering Department, where with different expertises that provide a nice combination for the work that we're doing in accident-tolerant fuel cladding materials. I also want to emphasize and acknowledge the wonderful students that we have in our program that have done this project a success. So the main motivation of our research project lies on the great advancement and progress on accident-tolerant fuel cladding materials to provide safety and improve the performance of nuclear power plants. So, and this is to, again, provide a different alternative to zircaloy cladding materials. So the main technologies that we are focusing in this research project are first of all, the zircaloy coated cladding with chromium, and also the ficrol alloys, APMT, and C26M. I want to emphasize here that our project is being supported tremendously by GE Global Research, and they are providing us guidance and support, technical support, for the testing protocols that we are establishing in this project. So the main question of our work is how do these cladding concepts evolve at high temperatures? So I want to say here that thanks to the NRC, we have been able to continue with this project that started about 4 years ago through an NEUP program, a grant that we had, investigating the surface characteristics and the surface chemistry evolution of accident-tolerant fuel cladding materials at a high temperature. Specifically, we have been investigating a critical heat flux of these candidate materials. So, and then in this project, I have a couple of examples there from our previous work on circaloid 4 cold spray and PVD coated, chromium coated cladding materials. So we have obtained a huge amount of data in this previous project through the NEUP. So now with the NRC in particular, our goal is to investigate the oxidation and degradation of accident-tolerant fuel cladding materials in high temperature excursions, meaning under short time heating a rate, and looking at quenching and the performance of these materials and their quenching. So we are interested on investigating the mechanical properties and overall performance of these materials under the given conditions. This project is also looking toward the dry storage conditions. So we are simulating hoop stresses, and we are simulating temperature profiles that are characteristic in dry storage conditions. And then finally, we are looking at implementing non-destructive examination techniques. In particular here, we are looking at X-ray fluorescence spectroscopy as a way to determine or provide quality control strategies for coated cladding material. So let me walk you briefly through the research objectives that we have in this project. So the first one is looking at the ATF cladding in manufacturing and advanced characterization, looking at their properties and their surface characteristics. The second aim of this project has been looking at short-time temperature excursions. So the first and second objective of this project, we have done a significant progress, in particular at setting up the quenching facility and rapid temperature excursions device. Then our third objective has been looking at simulating dry storage conditions and ductility studies. So for this particular objective, we are getting a substantial technical support from GE Global Research. And finally, we are looking at developing X-ray fluorescence spectroscopy techniques as non-destructive examination tools. So these are the materials that we are investigating currently. So I have a few examples here. In the pictures, you can see the current circaloid 4 and chromium-coated circaloid cladding material. We are looking at two different materials, the cold spray technique and the PVD technique. We are also looking at ficryl alloys, both APMT and C26M. Now, these are all the variety of materials, advanced materials characterization techniques that we have in our university that is providing us with important information about these materials. In particular, we have microscopy tools, scanning electron microscopy, and transmission electron microscopy that allow us to look at microstructural features in the materials during and after testing. So we're looking at micro and nanoscale features. We also have X-ray diffraction to investigate the evolution of the microstructure as well. And finally, X-ray for electron spectroscopy, which we are using to investigate the surface evolution of the materials in the after the testing protocols. So just to give you a brief description of the materials that we're using, so I have a couple of pictures here for the chromium-coated circaloid 4. We are looking at, in figure A, you see the chromium-coated circaloid 4 by a cold spray. So we see that this is a thick, relatively thick coating of about 20, 25 micrometers in thickness. In the other side, we have the PVD-coated circaloid 4. So just to give you a visual representation of the materials that we are investigating. And we are also looking at these two different alternatives of ficryl alloys. So again, we're focusing at what the NRC has categorized as near-term cladding technologies. And then in these micrographs, we see that we are dealing with different microstructures of the ficryl alloys for the APMT and C26M. And we are very interested in this particular aspect because it will provide us information on how the microstructure affects the properties and a performance of the materials in the testing procedures. So this is the quenching device that we have been able to design and build at Virginia Commonwealth University. So I want to emphasize a couple of features here. So we are looking at induction heating to be able to rapidly heat the materials at rates that can achieve approximately 100 Celsius per second. And we have adapted to the system an optical pyrometry device to monitor the temperature of the material through the testing procedure. And you see in the figure on your right, we have incorporated different inlets to our system, in particular for so that we can provide steam and steam inlets, so when the material is being heated up, we can incorporate steam as well as argon in case we need to purge the system prior to testing. And finally, the quenching portion at the bottom, so we'll be flowing water. So we've been doing this testing by flowing water from top to bottom so that we can rapidly cool the materials under selected conditions. And you see here in the figure at the bottom the holder for the cladding specimens. So this is just a video to show you how we're running the experiments. The induction heating allows to basically induce current in the cladding material and ramp up the temperature of the cladding components. And then at a set time, which again we are establishing based on the protocols and recommendations by our by GE, and we are looking at there how the water flows from top to bottom. Again, we can control the rate at which the water is flowing, and we can monitor the temperature using a data acquisition system that you see on the right. Now, these are some preliminary results. So we have completed the stage of characterizing the temperature excursion device and calibrating it. So since we know that the accessibility to these accident-tolerant fuel cladding materials is not that easy, so we have been using Circaloy 4 and Circaloy 702 as surrogates to calibrate our device and identify the parameters that we want to use for the testing protocols. So here in these images, I'm showing you some preliminary results at different power levels that we incorporate in our induction furnace. And you see there in the graphs how we can control the temperature at which the testing, at which the materials are heated, and we can also control the heating rate in the experiments. So we are currently running experiments with the ATF cladding materials that we have in our facility. So this right now we are just compiling our results and providing insights on the surface characteristics in mechanical properties. So just to continue with the preliminary results that we have with the Circaloy 4 and Circaloy 702, we have conducted tests on looking at steam oxidation of the materials, rapid heating and rapid cooling or quenching. And this, you see here that we can evaluate the growth of the oxide layers in the materials. So in this particular case, since we are dealing with circaloids, we can see the oxide formation, the alpha phase and the prior beta phase. So again, this provides us with a baseline as we move on to the testing with ATF cladding materials. Now, another topic that is a part of this project is looking at techniques, non-destructive examination techniques, to for quality control of ATF cladding materials, in particular, looking at coated cladding. So one of the aspects that influences the performance of these materials is defects in the surface. So we are using and we are implementing this technology, XRF, X-ray fluorescence spectroscopy, as a way to identify features and defects in the surface of these materials, looking at cracks and a lack of coating in particular regions in the material. So we have done a tremendous progress in this component as well. And we are looking at this from both a sides, experimentally and computational. So we have one of the faculty is focusing on this component, looking at benchmarking through MCMP simulations. So we are characterizing the X-ray beam that we are currently using for this particular task, as well as looking at the signal that is expected to come from the analysis of these coated cladding materials using this particular technique, X-ray fluorescence spectroscopy. So we are aiming to implement it to identify features and defects in coated cladding. All right, so with this, I just want to wrap up my presentation with some concluding remarks. So the first one being that we are fully focused on investigating the near-term technologies, chromium-coated circaloid 4 produced by both PVD and cold spray, as well as ficrol alloys. We have advanced tremendously on the design and implementation of our induction furnace for the rapid temperature excursions, as well as the quenching procedures for the rapid cooling of these materials, looking at investigating the ductility, residual ductility of these materials after testing. Then we have conducted, again, preliminary tests on these circaloids that allows to characterize the testing device and provide us with protocols that we can implement later on in the ATF cladding materials. And finally, we have done a tremendous amount of work on MCMP simulations, looking at the X-ray fluorescence spectroscopy technique for non-destructive characterization of coated cladding materials. So now our future work, and this is the component that we are going to start early in the summer semester in the university with our students, is looking at the dry storage conditions and testing the dry storage conditions and temperature profiles that following the regulations and guidances that in the literature, so that we can identify the changes in mechanical properties of these materials after testing with our quenching facility. So with all that, I want to complete my talk. Thank you all for listening to my presentation, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rojas. Yeah, we can share a mic here. We've got a couple of questions on your presentation. The first one is, that's okay. And then it's your turn. So, in the ferrous chromium aluminum alloy that you're looking at, have any hydrides been seen in the grain structure that could reorient or create a potential through wall crack in the cladding? And if not, is that alloy then not taking up hydrides?
That's a very good question there. So currently we haven't identified any hydride formation in the ficrol alloys. So again, and this is with the critical heat flux studies that we have performed in the past. So now we are transitioning to high temperature excursion profiles, so short term, rapid heating and rapid cooling. So this is something that we will definitely be investigating with the results that we are collecting now.
Good. And I think this next one is really interesting as well. And so are you examining the vacuum drying conditions of the ATF cladding as part of the dry storage research? And if so, kind of What's the maximum temperature then that you're allowing the cladding to reach?
That is a good question as well. So yes, so we are following the regulatory and the guidances of reaching a 400 Celsius in temperature as it's being done with the Zircaloy. So those are our parameters that we are currently investigating. So we are looking at a particular temperature profile in the dry storage conditions and applying hoop stresses in the cladding material at the same time as while we're heating. So that is the simulation that we are doing with the cladding materials. So the mechanical testing portion, we have already designed the device, so it is a cone and mandrel mechanism to apply the hoop stresses and apply the temperature profile that is
So I like those detailed questions, but let me zoom out a little bit and ask you another one. And so is the purpose then of the research to evaluate certain cladding concepts, or is it more to develop an overarching kind of performance model at a more general scale, I guess?
Okay, so yes, so the basic or the fundamental question that we are trying to answer is investigating how rapid the accident-tolerant fuel cladding materials can respond in an incident scenario. So we are looking at rapid temperature excursions, right, and a quenching. So with that in mind, we can evaluate the mechanical performance of the material in these conditions and understand how ductile the material, the remaining ductility in the material after these kind of testings. So we are looking at a surface chemistry, looking at what oxides are formed, how thick they are, how much of the cladding react in this process, and again, how the material will transition later on to dry storage conditions and how how it affects the performance in dry storage. So that's the overall goal in the project.
Probably should have started with that question, but we got there eventually. But thank you very, very much, Dr. Rojas. Our next presenters are Dr. Henry Spitz and Jimmy Stringer. Dr. Spitz is a professor of nuclear and radiological engineering at the University of Cincinnati's College of Engineering and Applied Science. He holds joint appointments in the Department of Mechanical and Materials Engineering and the Department of Biomedical Engineering. After obtaining his doctorate from New York University, he worked as a senior research scientist at the Battelle Pacific Northwest National Laboratory, and thereafter at the Mound Research Laboratory in Miamisburg, Ohio. He joined the University of Cincinnati in 1991, where he established the Laboratory for Radiological Assessment and Measurement, where students learn methods and procedures measuring and analyzing samples containing radioactive materials. Dr. Spitz developed the University of Cincinnati In Vivo Radiation Measurement Lab, a whole body counter with two large shielded rooms containing multiple arrays of scintillating and high resolution detectors for in vivo measurement of internally deposited radioactive materials. He teaches undergraduate and graduate courses in health physics, radiation detection, environmental radioactivity, and nuclear forensics. Dr. Spitz and his students design and fabricate tissue substitute materials and anthropometric phantoms that are used by institutions worldwide to calibrate systems that measure internally deposited radioactive materials. His current research focus is to develop a practical, robust method for evaluating direct in vivo measurement results of internally deposited isotopic mixtures of uranium, plutonium, americium, and other actinides relevant to the composition of new and mixed oxide nuclear fuel waste streams related to small modular and advanced reactors. Jimmy Stringer is currently a PhD candidate at the University of Cincinnati. Mr. Stringer graduated from Xavier University with a BS in physics in 2009. Mr. Stringer continued on to receive a Master's of Science in Medical Physics from the University of Cincinnati School of Medicine in 2011. After his bachelor's and master's degrees, Mr. Stringer was commissioned as an officer in the United States Air Force, where he served 4 years as an active duty bioenvironmental engineer and medical physicist, and 5 years in the Air National Guard. During his tenure in the U.S. Air Force, Mr. Stringer created a career progression pipeline for medical physicists in the Air Force, deployed to Afghanistan, and was chief bioenvironmental engineer for the Mansfield-Lom Airfield. After his military service, Mr. Stringer was recruited to the Ann Arbor Veterans Hospital, where he eventually became the chief of medical physics. Currently, Mr. Stringer is a clinical diagnostic medical physicist for the University of Cincinnati Health System. Mr. Stringer is board certified through the American Board of Radiology and Therapeutic Medical Physics and Diagnostic Medical Physics. The topic of their presentation will be in vivo measurement of low energy photons following internal exposure to waste streams derived from mixed oxide nuclear fuels. I now turn it to Dr. Spitz and Mr. Springer.
Thank you. Let's go back just one. I'd like to thank Nancy Hebron Israel and, of course, Casper Sun for giving us the opportunity to make this presentation about our research. Our study involves a forward-looking evaluation of a method to monitor workers who may receive occupational exposure to these new waste streams that will be generated by new designs for nuclear reactors and fuels. These waste streams are predicted to contain a much greater, much more significant quantity of actinides than those present now, and that provides us with increased potential for risk. Our research team involves nuclear engineers, health physicists, and chemists, and builds upon many years of developing methods to measure and evaluate internal radiation exposure. Now, our experience, our meaning the collective ours, our experience with high burn-up mixed oxide nuclear fuels reveals a very complex waste stream containing transuranic isotopes of americium, plutonium, neptunium, curium that emits a polyenergetic spectrum of low-energy X-rays and photons ranging from just teens up to about 120 keV. And I'm showing you the photon spectrum for a couple of those, but this is what we expect to see. And trying to measure that in vivo, in a person, is quite challenging. Since we expect to observe a much more complex polyenergetic spectrum in these new waste streams, it's really necessary to improve monitoring methods for those that might be exposed to accommodate this change. Now, the first line method to measure occupational exposure, to measure and evaluate occupational exposure, involves, as you see on the right-hand illustration, the picture, placing detectors on the chest of a worker to detect activity in the lungs. The generic name for this is whole body counting, but more so it's now called direct bioassay versus indirect bioassay, where we collect excreta from a worker. The detectors are calibrated using phantoms. These are surrogates for the human structure that you see on the left-hand illustration. And these surrogates, these phantoms, are made of materials that simulate lung, muscle, fat, and bone. Now, the original materials that were made for the phantom shown in this slide were developed in the 1970s. Now that's back when even I was a graduate student, and I got involved in actually evaluating this phantom for the Department of Energy. The materials that were used for the surrogates are base of a polyurethane and calcium carbonate. And the recipe for this was determined empirically, trial and error, by mixing different amounts of calcium carbonate to produce the kind of radiological characteristics of bone, muscle, lung. And we try to match the mass density, the electron density, the effective atomic number, the Z effective, and the attenuation coefficient. We've done this empirically. Now, the new formulations for tissue substitutes to work best with what we're expecting in these new waste streams, we cannot be determined empirically. They have to have an analytical method to help us come up with a recipe that will work. And that's what Jimmy is going to talk about today.
Thank So D.R. White established the mathematical basis for analytical development of tissue equivalence through the direct interaction method. And essentially, this is the cornerstone of modern-day tissue equivalent material design. White's method allowed the tissue substitute designer to create a list of appropriate additives to combine with a base material to achieve tissue equivalence at a single energy. Our method combines White's method and an optimization routine to explore tissue equivalence for an entire energy spectrum. So the experimental radiation physicist typically designs tissue equivalent materials to have tissue equivalence around a specific tissue type, radiation energy range, and radiation type. Tissue equivalence presents a stoichiometric challenge, especially when trying to mimic radiometric qualities of human tissue over a large range of energies. Characteristics such as atomic number, electron density, and physical density are critical to ensure that a tissue equivalent material effectively simulates the radiometric qualities of human tissues. When a material meets the design requirements to radiometrically mimic human tissue, it is termed tissue equivalent material. The interaction probabilities of human tissue vary based on tissue type. As can be seen from the graphs, the contribution of photoelectric to the total cross-section will change not just based off of energy, but also based off of tissue type. For the femoral head, which contains a lot of calcium, photoelectric is gonna be pretty high at the lower energy ranges compared to fat. And so your tissue equivalent, your analytical method must take this into context. Now, the fundamental underpinning of the analytical tissue equivalent design method is matching the attenuation coefficient of the substitute material to the biological tissue under predefined conditions. And in theory, we would like to match the entire energy range for our attenuation coefficient. But there is, we can't do this even with our analytical method because there's no combination of materials that you can mix together to match the entire energy range for a biological tissue. That's just a limiting piece of it because of the materials that we have available to us. The reason why we have these predefined conditions, or the reason why they were designed, is to make the formulation of tissue equivalent materials mathematically, computationally feasible, and empirically organized. Utilizing D.R. White's analytical method, the tissue designer would determine the amount of constituent material to combine to match the radiometric characteristics of the desired biological tissue. The determination of constituent material contribution presents an analytical mathematical problem that can be solved with analytical mathematical methods. Now, when we take a look historically, analytical methods utilized some of the preliminary analytical methods or methods used to design tissues utilized, as Dr. Spitz said, polyurethane and calcium carbonate as the additive, and didn't use a large group of additives to be able to design our tissues. The additive is used to increase the effective Z, the electron density, and the overall attenuation coefficient of the base material. While utilization of calcium carbonate is reasonable, it has the consequence of causing significant increase in the amount of photoelectric effect at the lower energy ranges because of the high Z of calcium. And this may be completely appropriate for tissues such as bone, where calcium is a large constituent of the chemical makeup there, but it's inappropriate, once again, for things like soft tissue, adipose, and muscle, especially if we're concerned about matching throughout the entire spectrum. This is to say, if I match the total cross-section at a higher energy for muscle, I might be causing a over response at the lower energy due to photoelectric. So when you're designing this analytical method or this optimization, you have to keep that in mind, that it's not just the total cross-section that we're considering, we're also considering the individual interactions that occur at the photoelectric Compton and so on and so forth level. While White's methodology is widely used, its use is only appropriate for a very limited energy range tissue substitute design. Multi-energy tissue substitute design creates a higher level of mathematical complexity where no definite answer can be determined that will exactly match all the attenuation coefficients at all energies. With multi-energy tissue substitute design, the problem of determining appropriate tissue equivalent material component weightings is still analytical, but a reasonable solution can only be attained numerically. The numerical method needs to give the best approximation for a solution that optimizes the match of the attenuation coefficients between the tissue substitute and the material and the biological tissue at multiple energies. Mathematical optimization allows the user to determine the maximum or minimum value of an objective or a cost function. The user can also constrain the optimization for specific variables that may impact the outcome of your optimization. This is known as constraining your optimization. The fundamental conditions of our optimization problem is mathematically described above. We want to minimize the difference of the attenuation coefficient for biological tissues and tissue equivalent materials for all energies. This optimization has constraints that limit the variance between the tissue equivalent material and biological tissue at each energy. This is to say that instead of telling the optimization routine to perfectly match the attenuation coefficient at each energy bin, we allow for a reasonable amount of variance. The reasonable amount of variance allows for a solvable problem because, as stated previously, there is no combination of materials that exist that will exactly match the attenuation coefficient at each energy bin and under any circumstances. The other constraint dictates that the total constituent weighting factor will need to add up to one. This also means that the constituents that the algorithm calculates will be 100% of the total volume of the tissue equivalent material. In this research, our team utilized the limited memory Broyden-Fletcher-Goldfarb-Shannon algorithm. This algorithm is an iterative quasi-Newtonian optimization method that utilizes the direction of steepest descent to minimize an objective function. This algorithm calculates the derivative of a cost function to determine a direction of descent and iteratively searches for a minimal value. For minimization problems, the cost function is typically the squared difference between a true value and the algorithm's guess per iteration. Steepest descent methods require the selection of a starting point and the determination of a direction, but it also requires that your cost function be differentiable and smooth. The cost function that we chose has two weighting variables, WP and WI. WP determines the importance of minimizing density error versus minimizing the error of the attenuation coefficient. Increasing the weighting value for density increases the likelihood of matching the density of the tissue equivalent material while allowing a smaller penalty for error in attenuation coefficient error. Reduction of error for the attenuation coefficient and density are competing design parameters. WP can be a value from 0 to 1 and scales the square values and scales the square errors for density and attenuation. WI is the volumetric weighting factor for each tissue substitute component. WI considers the relative importance of the energy and the interaction type to be matched. This is done by calculating the energy loss term with a normalized relative spectrum contribution. By weighting the energy loss term, the relative spectral photon contribution, the importance of the interactions and the energies that occur more frequently is increased, therein decreasing the penalty for not matching less frequent energies and interactions that will occur, are less likely to occur within your spectrum. The algorithm is based on the selection of a single base material and iteratively increases the amount of additive contributed until the tissue substitute material's radiation characteristic matches the biological tissue. Extensive knowledge of the chemical composition of the base materials and additives are needed to appropriately model the tissue equivalent material. Because of the proprietary nature of the available base materials, polyurethane, we had to obtain radiation characteristics of the base empirically, which kind of, you know, that kind of extended our research some because we had to actually go in the lab and measure the radiometric characteristics of our base and not get them from modeling. So what does our optimization require? Human tissue coefficients from ICRU 46 or 44, that gives us what we need to match to. Measured coefficients of our base, as we said before. Calculated attenuation coefficients from our additives using XCOM, which is a NIST database that allows you to determine the attenuation coefficients for a multiple number of chemicals and elements. And also, what does it spit out for you? It spits out the volumetric weighting for our additives in our base. So it'll tell you this is how much of your base you need to add, and this is how much of your additive you need to add to get the tissue equivalence that you desire. So We had to manufacture these tissue equivalent materials once we got our answers from the optimizer. And essentially, we have a high purity germanium detection system, americium europium source, and we took that. We essentially did attenuation measurements where we took measurements with our material inside the beam versus divided by the measurements without the material in the beam, and we attained our attenuation coefficients from there. So preliminary kind of measurements comparing to ICRU 44 is that we get really, really good agreement between what we calculate using our optimizer versus what ICRU 44 and 46 says we should get. And this is particularly for fat. And right now it's underway that we're designing tissue for muscle and for bone. And we expect some of the same results. So these are our preliminary results from our experimentation. So in conclusion, optimization method was applied in the formulation of an adipose tissue substitute that exhibits desired radiological response between 13 and 200 keV. Our ongoing research collaboration, once again, we're developing, we already have the optimization done for the muscle bone. We have not done it for lung. And our next step is to, with that, is to actually make it and measure it. And then we're going to design and fabricate a revised thorax phantom for in vivo measurement of mixed oxide nuclear fuels. Thank you.
Thank you both very, very much for that. Mr. Stringer, I may start with you. The question I've got is, did you have any better blueprints, references to build your phantoms other than the information provided in both ICRU reports 44 and 46? And if yes, kind of what area and why is it better than that of the ICRU reports for your R&D?
So I think the fundamental concern of our research was to see if we could create a piece of software or algorithm that could, where we could take two different or multiple different constituents to get a desired attenuation coefficient. So the resources or the references that we use are relevant when we bring this for actual research. But first, the initial piece was just making sure that our optimizer could give us an answer. So that's the first piece. Mm-hmm. Second piece is we're not looking to make better formulations. We're not looking to improve ICRU 44 or ICRU 46. We're just looking to match, to be able to make tissues that can match the attenuation coefficients from those resources. So it's not, we're not trying to improve ICRU 44/46. That's not what we're trying to do.
Yeah, yeah, okay. So in that case, it's really, rather than using live tissues or a live subject, right, basically to come up with that substitute that acts the same way.
Essentially we're saying, hey, yeah, we have polyurethane, we have these additives,
yeah,
in what ratio can we add these to get what the ICRU says we should get for prostate,
okay,
for bone. It's not an improvement on those formulations or on those attenuation.
No, please. Yeah.
So back in the 1970s when we were making recipes for tissue standards, we were concerned only about plutonium. That was the reason that you saw that phantom. That's why it was developed. It was to be able to evaluate plutonium in the lungs. And the recipes that were developed were tested. You can't do this today, but we had volunteers inhale not plutonium, but they inhaled labeled particles of niobium and palladium. And we intercompared the phantom response to the actual response of the individuals who were measured in vivo, and we determined, hey, this matched well. Mm-hmm. And we compared the response at several different measurement sites, usually the national labs, but this was an international study. But all of that was for, let's just say, 20 keV. Our challenge now is to develop tissue substitutes that go from the teens up to 120 keV, because we're not just interested in plutonium-239, the weapons material. We're interested in a lot of other actinides that have a whole range of photon and X-ray energies that will help us determine whether a person has been exposed to the point where we have to take remedial action. And we don't have that right now, because the materials and the calibration device are for lower energy photons, not for this continuous range of photons.
It's interesting you brought up plutonium, and that, because as you both were talking, this was part of what I was thinking, and I'm struggling to remember the name of the individual who was exposed at Hanford in the plutonium finishing plant back in the day.
Well, I knew that individual very well.
Okay. Did we learn anything from that person?
We have a whole issue of the Health Physics Journal that was published that has results of all of those measurements. I don't think we really have a lot of time to go into that.
No,
I'd love to.
But were the things that we learned from that relevant or
unfortunately, the worker was exposed to americium-241, and he had a lot of shrapnel in his face, so we weren't able to measure the plutonium.
I see.
We were measuring americium-241. He was involved in an accident at a glove box where the front exploded. And there were ionization, ion exchange columns loaded with americium. So he got a lot of americium in his body. We did learn that our radiation protection standards are adequate. But this was an accident, incident, and a very complex situation. But it wasn't plutonium.
Thank you for clearing that up for me. This next question was one I had the exact same thought on. The phantoms in the pictures in your slides were appeared to be based on male anatomy. And are there tissue differences in female anatomy taken into account, or how are they taken into account, for example, mammary glands in a chest scan, et cetera?
Yeah, so to give you some perspective on that, our research not only has applications here, but it also has applications in medical physics for designing phantoms for like CT scanners and for dosimetry for radiotherapy. So what you see in that image is actually a electron density to Hounsfield unit calibration phantom that we're designing using the same sort of tissue design ideas that we discussed here today. And yes, there are differences. From just some of the preliminary research that we've done, there's differences between bone density, size, all that stuff, between men and women. Racially, there's differences in bone density and size of anatomy. So there's a whole spectrum that exists that really needs to be investigated to understand how radiation actually differs in deposition for men, for women, for somebody who's 60 versus somebody who's 18 versus a black male versus a white male. There is some substantial anatomical differences that we want to investigate with our research and that we want to investigate through finding those differences through or really, really highlighting those differences in designing of tissue equivalent material through our algorithm. So, yes.
Thank you very, very much. Thank you both. Our final speakers are Dr. Bensi and Joy Shen. Dr. Bensi currently serves as an assistant professor in the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering at the University of Maryland. She's an affiliated faculty member of both the University of Maryland Center for Risk and Reliability and the University of Maryland Center for Disaster Resilience. Dr. Bensi's current research centers on the application of probabilistic risk assessment concepts and tools, as well as statistical machine learning techniques, to problem solving involving engineered systems, particularly nuclear power reactors, exposed to natural hazards. Dr. Bensi focuses primarily on topics related to the probabilistic assessment of natural hazards and risk-informed applications. Dr. Bensi works with many natural hazard groups for example, seismic, coastal, and fluvial flood hazards, as part of her research activities, and aims to transfer knowledge and lessons across those conventional disciplinary divides. Dr. Bensi serves as a full member of the American Nuclear Society and the American Society of Mechanical Engineers Joint Committee on Nuclear Risk Management, and chairs the working group responsible for the ASME standard for external flooding PRA at nuclear power plants. Prior to joining the University of Maryland faculty, Dr. Bensi worked right here at the NRC, where she was heavily involved in the agency's response to the Fukushima Daiichi reactor accidents. Dr. Bensi earned her PhD in civil engineering with designated emphasis in computational science and engineering from University of California, Berkeley. Joy Shen obtained a BS in mechanical engineering with a minor in nuclear engineering from the University of Maryland at College Park. She continued her education there and currently is a PhD candidate in the Reliability Engineering Program, advised by Dr. Shelby Bensi and Dr. Mohamed Madaris. Her research interests include Bayesian network modeling, external flooding PRAs, and PRA tool research. The topic of their presentation will be advances in PRA technologies and a hybrid approach to PRA development. I'll now turn it over to Dr. Bensi and Joy Shen.
All right, so I'm short. We have a lot of short women on the stage today. In the interest of diversity, podiums should be shorter. All right, I have a different topic, right? We had fuels, we had human tissue, now we're talking about external hazards and risk assessment. So we're going to talk today about an ongoing project we have looking at a hybrid approach to external hazard risk assessment. Particularly, we're focusing on external hazards. In the interest of the time constraints, we're going to sort of keep this high level, but I'll stick around after and talk to you more about it. All right, so if you're a PRA practitioner, you're aware that PRAs have been the foundation for risk-informed decision-making for decades. The nuclear industry really pioneered probabilistic risk assessment and has been instrumental in the development of PRA tools and methods. Because of this decades of investment, the industry has a very robust and extensive experience base in PRA. And now we have very robust models at each of the individual plants that encode. Is it too quiet? All right, so that now I actually can hear me. All right, so you heard something along what I said earlier, maybe?
Yeah.
All right. Anyway, you have this extensive knowledge. You have these plant PRAs that encode a substantial decades worth of plant knowledge and experience. However, these tools that were pioneered in the nuclear industry and are continued to be used are based on technologies that reflect some of the capabilities and characteristics of the time in which they were initially developed. So things like event trees and fault trees, which we're calling here these conventional PRA tools, they may not be reflecting all the advances in capabilities that we have today. That being said, they encode this extensive knowledge. They've enhanced our knowledge of plant risks, of plant systems. They've provided a great deal of insights. But because of the nature of these tools, they do have some key limitations. So some of those being they had some inherent independence assumptions. There's the static treatment of time, at least from the perspective of the logic structure. There's some binary assumptions that are built into those tools. And as PRA, the use of PRA has expanded, the scope has expanded, the technical complexity and sophistication has expanded, those limitations have been an issue. So there have been various workarounds that have been developed over the years. Some of these workarounds are great. Some of them may, you know, reduce accuracy. They may mask vulnerabilities. And even when they do work well, at the very least, they do reduce overall model transparency. And so as you've had this growth of and continued development of these PRAs in the nuclear industry, as I mentioned, you've had continued research and development in PRA methods in general. So there are alternate techniques available that can be used. So we're in this situation now where we have, on one hand, this really, really robust experience base built in these conventional legacy PRA tools. And then on the other hand, we have some more modern methods that maybe overcome some of those limitations that are in the conventional tools. They have some limitations themselves. So what we want to be able to do is link these two things so that we can get the best of both worlds. And so that's actually what we're focusing on here in this particular research project is looking at this notion of a hybrid framework. And we're zeroing in on external hazards because external hazards really highlight some of these challenges related to the inherent characteristics of these conventional PRA tools. And specifically, we're zeroing in on external flooding as a target of focus. And the reason for this is, one, external flooding extra highlights some of these particular challenges. But also, there's some co-benefits. There hasn't been a lot of investment from across the industry in external flooding PRA over the years. So if we're going to focus on a hazard, let's focus on one where we can actually look at these hybrid tools, but we can also advance the state of knowledge as we're going about doing that. So what exactly are we doing? So this is the sort of task breakdown of this overall project. So we began with a survey and assessment of what risk methods and tools are out there in the literature that have been used in practice. Next, we had a tasking to engage the broader PRA community to gather their insights about what are the current tools, what are their capabilities, what are their limitations. Originally, this was going to be a great in-person engagement, and then the pandemic happened, and we didn't. And so we actually used a questionnaire, which Dory will talk about, which turned out to work well. We then engaged further with the community via some conferences. We identified the need for some supplemental vendor engagement. And then building on all those information and insights from that review and that engagement, we're building a framework for this hybrid risk modeling approach, and then demonstrating it via a case study, and then finally looking at how the use of such a framework would impact risk-informed decision-making, and what are the potential implications of that framework. So now I'm gonna turn it over to Joy Shen. Joy is a PhD candidate, but she's also the lead graduate researcher working on this project. So Joy, take it away. I think this is the largest room you've ever presented in, so. Yeah, awesome.
Thanks for reminding me. As Dr. Bensi just said, we engaged with the international PRA community through an anonymous questionnaire. We were pleased to have received over 50 responses, and from that we gained insights on advantages and limitations of the current fleet of PRA tools, as well as allowing us to understand and identify the trending needs of the PRA community. So from there, it was interesting to find out that insights were a bit in the eye of the beholder. For example, for some respondents' advantages, there were others' limitations. So after this initial study, we engaged with vendors of conventional PRA software. This provided them an opportunity to further discuss, clarify their respective tools. And as a result of that, we interestingly found out that some of the challenges and limitations provided by the respondents didn't quite reflect the actual capabilities of the existing tools. So I would also like to mention this is still ongoing research, and if you're interested in providing feedback and your insights, you're more than welcome to by following the QR code at the bottom left. So if you're already submitting questions, you might as well give us your insights while you're at it. So we did a qualitative analysis on the responses that we had. We broke down our findings to two overarching themes. The first, as you see on the left, under technical modeling themes, and the other on the right of PRA software implementation and management. Beginning with the insights on the right-hand side, we saw an interest in integrating pre- and post-processing of data, as well as an interest in incorporating collaborative and version control features such as online repositories, which makes sense since PRAs are highly interdisciplinary. Moving back to the insights on the left-hand side under technical modeling themes, there was a strong interest in dynamic PRAs, as well as an interest in improving SSC dependency modeling, incorporating Bayesian updating capabilities, expanding the PRA scope to other applications, particularly external events, and as well as improving HRA capabilities. So as you'll see in a moment, we'll be focusing on four key insights under the technical modeling side of things, as you see in bold. We would like to acknowledge and recognize that there's a need and importance for dynamic PRAs. However, due to the scope of this project, and I would like to graduate soon, we will be incorporating the dynamic considerations through temporal dependence rather than developing a full scope dynamic PRA. So here's how we'll do it. We'll be beginning with the conventional external flood PRA framework that we all know and love. It consists of a hazard analysis, fragility evaluation, and plant response, which is based on event trees and fault trees. However, as Dr. Bensi mentioned, these models are not without their limitations. So in response, we'll be strategically integrating alternative modeling techniques into the conventional PRA framework to address the limitations of the conventional framework, such as the binary assumption, challenges to common cause failure modeling, et cetera. Specifically, we are proposing a Monte Carlo simulation augmented Bayesian network. It's kind of a mouthful. And from there, we'll be able to address some of the limitations that we just mentioned, as well as attempting to incorporate, or as well as incorporating the insights that we gain from the questionnaire responses. So as an example, this is a proposed Monte Carlo augmented Bayesian network. In this case, this is a Bayesian network that can probabilistically map external flood heights to internal flood heights while accounting a diverse set of random variables. The logic of this Bayesian network here follows the idea that there's an external flood. It affects a building on a nuclear power plant site. So we can first start by describing the external flood itself by modeling relevant random variables. In this case, we're modeling flood duration and water level for the relevant random variables, as well as accounting for site level and location specific hazards. Then moving on, once you've described the external flood, we must consider the condition and performance of the flood protection features. So for example, in this case, these nodes describe the pre-existing degradation of the flood protection features. In our example, we have leveraged NRC-sponsored research by Ma et al. To define the associated probabilities. Next, once we've modeled the pre-existing degradation or the condition of the flood protection features, we can look to the performance of those features, which is typically described by fragility and fragility correlations. However, it's fairly well known within the external flood PRA community that there isn't a lot of literature about flood fragility development. So in our case, we did an extensive literature review, particularly in this case on penetration seals. However, this can be applied to other flood protection features. And that consisted of an extensive review of manufacturing specifications of penetration seals, as well as looking at strategies and modeling techniques from other hazards, such as seismic, which has have relatively more development compared to external flood fragility development. And then finally, we can move on to describing the internal flood demand once we've been given the performance of the flood protection feature. So in order to understand the internal flood demand, we look to physical relationships and also to minimize the discretization error and reduce computational expense of, you know, running this pretty large Bayesian network. We use a Monte Carlo simulation to integrate out relevant random variables. And in this case, we have, as I mentioned before, probabilistically mapped it from the external flood height to the internal flood height, but we can also continue expanding this Bayesian network to include the performance of internal components within the interior of said building. So where's the hybrid part of this? We need to connect the results of the Bayesian network back into the conventional PRA model because, as Dr. Bensi mentioned, there's a lot of wealth and a wealth of knowledge in this framework. So we're considering two approaches to accomplish this. The first, as you see on the left, is the hybrid causal logic model, which has been developed by various researchers. This involves taking the Bayesian network results and inputting it into the fault tree, which then will inform the event tree. The other approach that we're considering is a more function-focused framework. This involves taking the results of the Bayesian network and directly inputting them into the event tree. So I'll pass it back to Dr. Bensi to finish out the progress that we've done.
Good. You did awesome, Joy. So where do we stand on this? So we have Most of the sort of background and outreach activities to date have been completed. So we've completed that literature survey, the engagement and the with the community, and the supplemental engagement with vendors. That being said, don't forget that QR code that Joy put up. If you want to add your thoughts to the data set, we can revise our results to reflect additional data. And then what we have right now is we do have that initial framework developed, and then we are actively working on that case study, as Joy showed. And then the idea will be, once we wrap up that case study, go back, maybe refine the overall framework. And then our next steps are to move on to looking at that risk-informed decision-making and what does using something like this hybrid framework, we can overcome some of those inherent limitations of the existing tools, what does it mean for risk-informed decision-making? All right, so with that, as we're wrapping up, I want to make sure I acknowledge my co-PI, Dr. Mohamed Medeiros. He's sitting down there in the second row. So he's obviously a key part of this project. Joy is the lead graduate student researcher, but she has received some support from additional students in both civil and mechanical engineering, as well as one anthropology student. So Konstantinos and Sam have supported as graduate researchers, and Olivia has helped a bit, particularly with the literature review activity. And we did just have to scratch the surface with some highlights. So we do have a few papers that have come out or that are forthcoming that we can share with you, or you can reach out to us via email. Or if you happen to be in the area next week, the NRC PFHA workshop is going to be happening, and Joy will also be presenting there. So that'll be a great opportunity for some further engagement if you would like to learn more and tell us your ideas. So thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Dr. Bensi and Ms. Shen. Do vendors of existing PRA software have improvements under development based on your survey responses, et cetera?
Sorry, I didn't hear it.
The question was, do PRA vendors have improvements development under development? Are they working to make them better? So you've actually talked a lot, so why don't you take that one?
Yes. As I mentioned, we engage with the conventional PRA vendors, and all of them had said, like, yes, we are listening to our end users, our clients, if you will, and there's a lot of the things that we brought up in regards to the trending needs within the PRA community, they were all very aware of it. For example, the collaborative and version control, that was a very common thing, theme that, or insight that was brought up by a lot of them, because I, you know, might have obviously been inspired by COVID and having to work remotely with everyone, and that really highlighted the need that we are all very, this is a highly interdisciplinary field, not just PRA, but nuclear in general. So, yeah, they are very aware.
Yeah.
I think if I could add too, as Joy mentioned this, that we got feedback that said tools couldn't do certain things. And then we were reporting what the survey, you know, the respondent said, and then the vendors were like, we can. And so there actually seems to be a communication mismatch that is happening that also is an interesting insight.
Yeah. With surveying all these different tools, I mean, is the grant effort going to kind of recommend one tool or another? And if not, which I would totally understand, how do you kind of avoid that, right? I mean, aren't people kind of pulling you aside at conferences and going, no, really, which one is better?
Yeah, so no, we are not going to, we are not going to play favorites. So I think one of the things that recognizes, right, is different PRA softwares serve different needs, they serve different constituencies, so I don't think we want to, you know, just say that one is better than the other. Now, for our purposes, given access and cost, we are doing a lot of work with that linking using Sapphire. And so that's what we are using. But with the framework we're trying to develop here, I would call it, we're trying to be tool agnostic. So we want to be able to develop this framework that would be useful, you know, regardless of what particular software application you're using. Now, if we were to ever go further to look at actual integration, now we need to work with specific softwares to do sort of the behind-the-scenes software-based linking.
Well, that's actually a great segue to my next question, which is, you know, could you all develop your own PRA software under the grant award?
The University of Maryland has in the past developed PRA software, like modules. I think if we're talking about commercial scale PRA software, the university is really not set up to do that scale of development, right? I think you know, that's a pretty big endeavor, and certainly not within the resources of the grant like this. But I think the developing, you know, modules that can do something like a Bayesian, a Monte Carlo simulation augmented Bayesian network, and then partnering with a software so we can create that linking, I think that's doable. But trying to come up with our, we're not gonna put Sapphire out of business.
It's almost like a probabilistic or Bayesian plug-in for for existing software.
Yeah.
If I understand.
Yeah,
that
right. Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. No, I think that's very, very, very interesting. For everyone on the panel as we move into this, and thank you again, Dr. Bensi and Ms. Shen, for your presentation. And the PRA stuff obviously is something we're really interested in at the NRC, which of course, Dr. Bensi, you know quite well. But I guess I wanted to kind of ask a question kind of for everyone on the panel. And that's, can you share some experience on how your grant research may have inspired your students to become the next generation of engineers in a general nuclear engineering field or maybe some other specific field? And do you think that some of these students may become, I love that, this is very leading, I'm just now reading this, right? Do you think that some of your students someday might want to come work for the NRC? Hint, hint, since we're looking for people, as you may have heard. and yes, there is a right answer. No, there isn't. But part of the idea here is obviously to benefit the agency, right? With technical research on things that are directly applicable to us, and we've seen that across the board today. But also, even when I go and visit universities, certainly I make the pitch for, hey, don't you want to spend a little time in public service? But really, it's also to encourage people more broadly in, hey, here's a world of possibilities around in the STEM fields and around engineering more generally, and here are the kinds of things that you can dive into and the hard questions you can really make progress on answering. And so that's also the point of these research grants for us, too. So, maybe each of you can just take a couple of minutes and kind of talk about the impact of some of this in supporting students as they kind of pursue their interests and their passions in these fields. Yeah, anybody can start.
Okay, I'll start. She wants to be a start. So I think that something like an NRC or any nuclear focused research grant is unique. You know, NSF can fund research on flooding, but only a grant like this can let us expose the students to the truly unique context in which we're talking about risk and we're talking about nuclear power facilities. So I think that's a particularly unique aspect, and then for students to see what goes into a risk assessment, for example, for nuclear power facilities. The other thing I think that's interesting is I talk with a lot of undergraduates and they think, you know, Nuclear Regulatory Commission, Department of Energy, nuclear power plants, they need nuclear engineers. And I have to explain, actually, that's a little piece of a nuclear reactor, right? It's all civil and mechanical. And so that's exactly what this particular grant is it's a partnership between civil and mechanical engineering to solve that. So now we can start, you know, students can start to, you know, that may not have been thinking about the nuclear industry in general, now they can start to think about this as a career pathway, even though their degree doesn't have nuclear in the name. And Joy, would you be interested in joining the NRC ever?
Love to, yes.
Actually, I have to say she's a unique student. She showed up to talk to Dr. Medeiros and me and said she wanted to do external flooding PRA. Like,
wow.
That is how you approached us, right?
Yes.
All right. That is fantastic and useful in all kinds of ways. I love it.
I'll give my perspective. So just going on the same line as Dr. Ben said, so we, in Virginia Commonwealth University, we have a hybrid department, mechanical and nuclear engineering. So we are somehow well positioned in the map, so the students always have the NRC in their eyes. So they see this entity as a potential employer for them. So, and again, this project has given us the opportunity to target undergraduate students and graduate students at the same time, and they are seeing all the benefits in all the different parts in the nuclear industry, not only in the experimental part, in computational part, in the research component, but also in the regulatory aspects as well. So it's been a really good opportunity for our students to recruit them, retain them, and show them different paths, and of course, in contact with the nuclear industry as well.
Thank you.
I've been at the University of Cincinnati for a long time, and the College of Engineering and Applied Science is a five-year undergraduate engineering program. It has a one-year mandatory co-op. And during the co-op time, the students are working in industry. And so the employer who pays them, this helps them with their tuition, the employer who pays them gets to see if they're going to be good employees in the future. And I must say, a number of the co-op employers hire their students. It's a very successful way to try out students and see if they do fit into your business. And the NRC is just another business to them. We have been successful in placing our undergraduate students with the Department of Energy, National Labs, industry. I have a couple of students down at the new plant starting up. They want, in fact, one student insisted on going down to Vogel because he wanted to be in a startup team. So I think the NRC is just another one of the employers that offers opportunities for our students. At UC, our nuclear classes are really treated as technical electives. We have students from all of the engineering disciplines and from medical physics and so forth, and they learn about the NRC and what it has to offer. And I know of two students that have gone to the NRC for part of their professional careers, and I would like to see the NRC, and I know you have programs for students to work at the NRC. This needs to be more publicized. I'd like to get brochures to hand out to students, because there are students for which the NRC would be a wonderful opportunity for them. It's exciting. There's research. Our research program is relatively small. We're very focused in a certain area. And in the past, we've had students, two students in particular, that came to the NRC for a while and enjoyed it very much. But there's a lot of competition. You know this.
Absolutely.
And it's send out brochures. Tell us about what's available. And I think you'll get more students that way and more employees that way. Yeah.
I think the point about the diversity of disciplines that we try to bring into the agency is really important. But Dr. Spitz, you raised a great question. We were kind of having this conversation about, you know, how do you... what are the pathways maybe to get into public service, whether at the Department of Energy or the NRC or other places? But one of the questions we got through the app was the flip side of that, which is kind of, what are the barriers to...
Money.
to newly
really,
trained scientists applying to work at the NRC or other places.
The students, when they graduate, whether they're graduate students or undergraduates, they have... already multiple job opportunities.
Yeah.
And they're not foolish. They're going to go where they've co-opted, and that's why I'd love to see a co-op offer co-ops. Mm-hmm. It's a challenge because the co-ops are not doing Xeroxing. They're actually doing projects.
Yeah.
And they get a taste of what's coming. This is the best way to get your employees and see if they fit.
Yeah.
To see if they fit. You make a big investment in hiring somebody, and that investment has to pay off. So the co-op experience is wonderful. The students, our students, don't stay in Cincinnati. They go all over the country, and they go international as well. But the bottom line for somebody just graduating college who's got debt, tuition debt, they want to go where they can help pay off their debt.
So my experience as a former military or as a veteran is with the GI Bill. And so I think if the NRC could implement something of that extent where you pay for education or you go back and do some reimbursement for prior education, you could probably get people to sign on for two or three years mm-hmm. post undergraduate education. I don't know if that exists, but I think that for a lot of people with the cost of the expense of college, knowing that, hey, I can get a good co-op opportunity and I can get some of my debt paid off and I can get the public service in 2 to 3 years post undergrad, that would probably attract a lot of people. So I think that sort of program, if you can do that, would work well.
Thank you. Dr. Bensi?
Yeah, I think we're in a unique situation because we're, you know, right down the street. And I know that UMD has hosted a number of the fellows mm-hmm. from the NRC, which is similar, I think, to what you said, where existing employees can pursue education. I think, Mohammed, I think you have a count somewhere of how many students have come to NRC, and it's a pretty good number, right? So, you know, I think one of the cool things about being here in the D.C. area is our students can come here. I know, I think there's six students maybe coming next week to the PFHA workshop. And so we, you know, our students have a little bit of a unique opportunity here locally to attend these types of conferences. DOE has, you know, similar conferences. So it's a pretty, you know, we're pretty plugged in, I think, to this particular career pathway. But am I right, Mohammed? You have, it's a pretty good number, right?
Okay. Thank you.
No terps?
Yeah, no. I think there's a lot there for us to kind of chew on and think about and work on and how to sustain that pipeline, right? Because the research ultimately that you all are doing, right, it's to move forward that body of knowledge that we're going to need to make robust and durable and regulatory decisions, right, that protect people and the environment. That's our mission. You know, but also there's this, you know, creating the ecosystem of research professorships and student interest in these topics as well, that then kind of benefit the entire, you know, not only the NRC, sure, but kind of the community writ large. So, that, to say nothing of then all of the, you know, the kind of incubators for innovation around this, right? Mm-hmm. The plug-in. The new model for phantoms, right? The important work on the performance of cladding under these kind of extreme conditions, right? All of that then leads to further developments that also then improve safety, performance, human health, the environment, and all of these good things. So I want to thank you all very, very much for being here today.
Thank you.
It's been a great pleasure to chair the panel. Thank you all for your research, and let's give them a round of applause. Thank you.